evening. I'm Dr. Kristalyn Shefveland. I organize this with my colleague in the Department of History, Stella Ress, who is our public historian, and we're very lucky to have her. She's going to be moderating our discussion tonight between three people who are invested in the historic past of Evansville. Philip Cooper, who is a sort of man extraordinaire, but most importantly, he is one of the founders of the Owen Block blockhead that saved the Owen Block in downtown Evansville. We also have Joe Engler from the Danbury Historical Society, who is the historic Evansville.com guy. All the amazing stuff that I know I certainly crib when I'm trying to bring in local resources into my classes. And we also have a USI history student, Lucas Neuffer, who is also a real estate agent, interested in historic properties around the city and is managing a Facebook page about that topic. So I think we have a lot of interesting discussion ahead of us. And I also encourage you to ask questions and to participate. This is not a traditional lecture. It's a roundtable discussion. So hopefully you can have a stimulating discourse on the topic at hand. Thank you. Okay, so
did you want me to do the presentation?
Yeah.
She asked me to prepare a little thing of kind of what I've been up to, and I'm going to go through fast. Real quick about myself, I'm from the area, grew up in Chandler, if you know where that is, Wark County, small town. Went to college outside of Chicago, Wheaton, and that's kind of where I fell in love with cities and the real estate development and all that kind of stuff. And I moved to Evansville in 2012 to lead the Department of Metropolitan Development for the city. Got my real estate license back in 2005 after my wife and I bought a house in an old neighborhood. That was fun. So I've been doing real estate on the side since 2005. Started doing full time a couple years ago. Love it. And have with my background in community development and city development for the city of Indianapolis and the city of Evansville. Picked up historic preservation through applied professional. I've never took a class in historic preservation in college, but picked it up. So I've been speaking a lot since I left the city about historic preservation. So historic preservation is good business. I've talked about that several times in Kiwanis groups and the historic group in Newburgh. And I've talked about the Owen Block social media campaign at the statewide conference and to another Kiwanis group. I thought I did the time table. And so a lot of what I presented at all of these really just regurgitates the National Trust for Historic Preservation's Displaced Matters campaign. And just go check it out. It's really awesome. It's a really effective campaign that utilizes social media. They have a great journal, Why Old Places Matter, and I lead people through this, and we talk about, and I'm not going to go into as much detail here tonight, because we're going to discuss it, but we talk about continuity, why does historic preservation matter, why is it important for economic development, whatever, continuity, memory, here's why I tell a story about my grandpa who just passed away, and I get emotional, he had this beautiful way of saying, the old words here have left their mark, in the state of Alzheimer's, you know, looking at that old barn, you know, brought back all these things. So place matters, right? It gets in our memories. Identity, beauty, history, it's sacred. It gets into creativity. It gets into making a place better. This is the house we bought in, and then we made it look better, and we used that better. It's better for the community, and it's better for quality of life, and crime goes down, all these good things. There's our garage. Thankfully, God thought it was ugly, too, and smashed it. And so we built back this. And this was my Marxist lesson in the value of labor, because I built it myself. And I realized that's why it costs so much to get contractors with it. But this is a great little photo in Newburgh, with the new event center in downtown Newburgh. And authenticity is a big part of this, you know, and that matters. It matters more and more the last 10 years. There's the inside of our building, so we need authentic space. You can see the trusses and all that kind of stuff. And just great, that almost looks like a marketing picture from a magazine. That's just an entrance there in Newburgh. And you learn things. You learn, oh my gosh, the Cafe Herzu is in an old ice house. No, that's the Newburgh Cafe Herzu, right? Now we have two. Sustainability is a big buzzword. You know, basically saving old buildings saves money. The community return on saving the Owen Block is huge. But the public had a hard time getting past why is there a subsidy gap? But there's a huge return on investment by just keeping it and saving it. Vectoring gets money, the city gets money, the people and the customers who walk to it. You know, it's a really big deal. It gets into our ancestors, it gets into beautiful things like this tower. Judy O'Bannon climbed all the way up to that. She was the best first lady ever. She's still living. She's like 70-some years old, climbs 80 feet up to the top of that tower because she's awesome. That's the inside of that building, and it kind of takes your breath away. I was on the board of the Old Central Foundation that saved this building, and it was amazing. It was Bill Cook's last thing. So here we're talking about Bill Cook, wealthiest guy ever in Indiana, and he rest in peace. We couldn't have saved that building without him. It was the last big philanthropic thing he did after French Lick. And I will read this. He said, simply put, we believe in community-wide impact of historic preservation. It's not just about what buildings, and it's not simply about preserving the past. It's about building for the future and benefiting entire communities. So the wealthiest dude, the medical instrument company, took that all the way. Cool stuff. Obviously, economics, we kind of talked about the sustainability. There's even geeky urban planning stuff. I won't go into these details, but it's more efficient. Literally, this technically old and blighted part of town has more tax assessment than the shiny and new Taco John's. This is straight up numbers. This is really for no other reason to remind you that in Newburgh, Indiana, there's a retaining wall. It's from 1808. I assume that was the address for years. And that was the first church in town, and the sandstone wall is still there, and there's a house on that wall. But so that's just amazing. 1808? Yeah, the bicentennial celebration for that, you know. So, and it's also important, you can just ask somebody at Cafe Arizona in Newburgh, hey, you like Newburgh? And she said, it's adorable. And I said, do you mean all of Newburgh? And she said, no, just the historic part. Is historic preservation good for your business? She said, absolutely. I think people are drawn to downtown Newburgh because they just historic preservation, local business, they feel part of their heart like historic Newburgh. And then the lady at the bookstore said, it shows a part of who we were, and we shouldn't forget who we were because who we are now is a part of who we were. This is just a sweet cantilever tower, and this is the building that started historic preservation in Newburgh because somebody tried to tear it down. And they said, no, you can't tear that down. That was a Civil War hospital. You can't tear that down. It's my property. Why shouldn't I go tear it down? There's all these impacts of it. This is my daughter, and she is terribly swinging at a T-ball practice. And if I don't have the guts to tell her, no, that's a terrible swing. Here's why, but love it. I'm not being a jerk. But you're loving. And that's where the rub comes in. If it's for preservation, whether we're saving one block or whatever we're trying to do, at some level, we get to start to where the rubber really meets the road when there's some differences. You know, somebody wants to do something and the community doesn't. And getting through that can be really tricky business. This building is standing because the people who want to tear down ran out of money, literally. And so we almost idolize our forefathers sometimes, but we're really glad that our forefathers were wrong. They ran out of money. And we love them, and they did so many great things, but they were wrong on slavery, they were wrong on a lot of stuff, and they were also wrong because we wanted to tear down this. What I'm up to now, real estate, this, some people think it's funky. It's not just the really, really old stuff. This is an architect design 1950s house. And if you talk about architecture right and real estate right, it kind of sells itself. I got this to be the fourth most popular listing in the United States of America. Not because I'm the fourth best real estate person in the United States of America, but just it was the architecture speaking for itself. It went crazy. Here's another maybe more stereotypically historic home, because it's a little old, 1920s Tudor. This is the house that built the suburbs. The suburban mansions are designed after this today, which are millennial mansions, are designed after this today. The hip roof, all those that form. This was 1923, one of the first attached garages in the city. Super baller, you know, Wright's Hill. You know what Wright's Hill is? This guy made his money taking all the coal out of the hill and selling it. He was like a mining magnate. Kind of like Steve Chancellor today. He was major. He built a beautiful house, just a summer house up by the country club. You know? So it was major baller in 1923. This was the most popular listing in the United States of America, even though it was flea infested and needed a big renovation project, because there was that much bones to it. And a it doesn't have to be, and this is the future man, it doesn't have to be old. This is a 2006 architecture, condominium renovation. I got to be the second, not first, but second most popular listing in the country. Again, I think it's the architecture speaking for itself. So at some level, historic preservation gets into what the community wants, but also gets into architecture. So that's a little bit about who I am. I'm trying to be quick. I have a real estate broker now. I'm just doing development consulting a little bit, and honored to be here and honored to get to help talk about architecture and historic preservation.
People that who want to get rid of that. I mean, I know there's groups that, you know, like you guys who want to fight for it. Who are the people who don't want it?
The people who don't want it.
The Greyhound.
Oh, it's there now.
I know it's there, like it's Brewing now, but who wanted, I mean, is there like groups of people that, so a lot of groups that go against, you know?
Yeah, I mean, it might be a developer that says, hey, I would love to put a strip mall and a gas station there. That almost happened. Because wouldn't it be great to sell out there? And we kind of need a gas station downtown. Say, no, you don't need a gas station downtown. They're fine where they are. They attract every negative of our society. Student walking into the IU, USI, UE medical school campus is going to feel probably less safe having to walk by a gas station at night. You know, we don't want a gas station downtown, in my opinion. But it's you know, it's just because they can sell it. And for a long while, it was a big question mark. What are we going to do? And sometimes the community needs to be reminded that people care, and it's not just 12 dorks downtown who think it's cool. And Greyhound, I'm glad you mentioned that, because it was a very good project, because on some level, from when that started in the Weinzapfel administration to save the building and do something cool with it, and there was a long several-year process of, okay, who's going to go in and do that cool thing on the inside? And it's like crickets and what. You know, can you sell a $15 cheeseburger downtown? You know, all those things. It gets into the business plan and the economy of what can happen there. So it's not just that people wanted to tear it down because they hated it. Certainly some people didn't realize how cool it was because it had been painted with latex paint, and so the original sheen of the original process of the paneling was totally muted, and it just looked kind of weird. Like that 50s house I mentioned, a lot of people think it looks like a maintenance shed at a school corporation. Okay, you know. And so some people thought it was weird, but it was more of we can put a strip mall here and the gas station, why shouldn't we? And then so when the ribbon cutting happened, that was the most beautiful thing, because it was kind of like the end of Cars when the lights come on, the neon lights come off in the car movie, because they turned the neon lights on. But people came out of the woodworks like crazy for that. And it was unofficial. Landmarks didn't call people and tell them to come. The mayor didn't desperately call people and say, please show up to this hearing and vote for this. You know, and those things happen sometimes in politics, right? Hey, we really need you to come support this. We really need you to come to this party. We're afraid the levy's going to come. They just had a ribbon cutting and like 2,000 people showed up. So that helped, I think, the community say, wow, historic preservation really does mean something. It's not 12 people. It really means something.
And I think, too, the fact that they even opened it up and saw the inside, you know, most people that even knew of it never went inside because they never rode a bus.
Yeah.
So, you know, when they had it, I think right after they, I think, procured it and opened it up for tours, it was pretty derelict. It had like neat old tile in there. It had a lot of things. It had a lot of, you know, things. But I think they had a couple of people with Greyhound pets there. And, you know, my wife and I actually went there last weekend, and there was probably a 40-minute wait.
I'm from Cleveland. I can tell you like about some bad, scary places, and Evansville doesn't have them.
I do want to add, Evansville is one of the safest large cities per capita in like a huge, all over the country. When we were doing some med school data, because that was one of the perceived challenges of convincing the powers that be that the campus ought to be located downtown instead of east side or Warwick County. It was like, well, the crimes downtown. You know, Evansville per capita murder rate is the lowest of any city over 100,000 people in an 800-mile radius, and then the data is there. And when I came from India, I remember asking Billy Baldwin, the chief of police, what's our murder rate here? And he said, I didn't say murder rate. I said, how many murders a year? Or maybe I did say that. Anyway, and he was kind of confused by the way I asked the question, because we only have like four. And he said, four? And I was like, wow, you mean like four per 100,000, which is the normal way of putting crime. Well, in our population, it's a little bigger than 100,000. But he's like, no, like four total. Like last year we had like, I think, two or three. And I was like, what? And I got so excited. Because if we had Indy's murder rate, we'd have like 20 to 30 murders. So we really do have a safe city.
It's very funny. You know, like it's a big, dangerous place.
Yeah.
I have a question about governmental and official support for preservation efforts. And one thing that occurs to me, in Britain, I'm a British historian, in Britain, historic buildings have very strict regulations about what can be done with them. And so my question is twofold. Do you see increasing support among government officials to support preservation efforts? And secondly, are they imposing any kind of restrictions on what kind of preservation efforts can take place?
Yeah, follow the National Trust on that. In some ways, the populace, the people, the citizens, millennials, any way you want to slice it, I think there is a growing interest in historic preservation. But there's also a huge number of threats. Statewide, state legislatures can try to enact it. It almost got banned in Indiana when somebody in my neighborhood in Irvington put in windows without permission from the commission and commission. And Indy, thankfully for the concept of preservation in Indy, the commission in Indy has a lot more teeth and are willing to sue a citizen for doing something wrong. And really come to the table with some legal teeth that are drinking. And they talked to the city council, they talked to the state reps, and it was dicey for a while. So there are threats to it because it gets into property rights. Why can't I change the windows out? And how do you make that case? So, making the case for historic preservation, at least in America, is always almost always a neighborhood by neighborhood thing. So it's a local government thing. And so that's why I'm so excited about the success of the Owen Block and the Peters-Margedant House and the Greyhound, because hopefully our local leaders, Republican or Democrat, can see, okay, there really is a community win here, and we do need to recognize that when the district was made in the 70s, or let's say, forget the exact date, the Riverside Historic Preservation District, it was the citizens who led that. And there was kind of a Republican and kind of Democrat working on it. And there was this neighborhood residents who said, we want to do this. But at the end of the day, like the T-ball swing analogy of my daughter, at the end of the day, it involves somebody telling somebody no, and particularly local politicians don't like to do that. Because their friend owns that company that did the windows. Or there's a number of reasons why. Or you're just a nice mayor. Mayor Lloyd is a nice, Wood Winkie is a nice mayor, you know. It hurts sometimes to have to tell somebody no. And so that's also a threat as well. But by and large, I would just encourage you to check the National Trust, because they'll have legislative alerts about, hey, you know, North Carolina can do something dumb, whatever.
But I do want to make it clear that there are different levels of preservation, so not everything is designated by the National Trust.
Right.
So
it's just a good resource to go to.
Yeah. So the very first level of historic preservation is on the Register of National Register of Historic Places, and you are allowed to change your windows. You can do anything
right
to your house. So that's just, yeah, that has no bark, or no bite at all, excuse me, it has bark, but no bite at all. But once you get into like local preservation or even state by state restrictions, those can be much more tight and controlling, right? As you mentioned, landmarks, Indian landmarks and the overseas.
And it can vary by, the local districts can vary in what they do and the strenuousness with which they apply the standards. And it can vary neighborhood to neighborhood. Unfortunately, Evansville only has one locally designated historic district where there's teeth. There's national ones. Washington Avenue is a national. If you look at the Vandenberg County survey, architectural survey, they have, this is a really good document, and it last updated probably in the 90s. But the Riverside, and this is what gets confusing, the Riverside National District that has just a few legal teeth, if you're going to use federal money in the area, it triggers some things, is bigger than the Riverside local district. So, yeah, but so when I was at D&D, I was hoping that we could do a couple of new districts, and politically, both capital P with the powers that be, but also the residents weren't necessarily gaining. You know, I think Blackfoot's Grove should be a preservation district. It blows my mind the quality Italianate architecture in Blackfoot's Grove that anybody could just jackhammer down tomorrow. North Main Street and West Franklin Street, in my opinion, should be preservation districts. And in Indy, they use the tool called conservation districts, it's just what they called it. And it was a pared down historic preservation district where it prevented demolition. It only reviewed new things if it was a brand new building or a new addition. So think if you're adding on to the foundation over the earth, you'll get it reviewed. But if you're just covering up your brick building with vinyl siding, have at it. You know, if you want to brick up all your windows, have at it. It's just the minimal protection of demolition. It's to keep that CVS from coming in, which happened in my neighborhood, Irvington. Imagine the lava block building and an entire block of West Franklin gone for a CVS and a strip mall. That can happen. There's nothing to stop that. And you could say, well, that's not going to happen because Westsiders love West Franklin Street, but you get one property owner with, you know, grandson with some medical bills, he needs that money. And then there's that terrible road again. We're telling the grandpa with medical bills, you can't tear down the lava block building. And at some level, we have to make a case for, in certain situations, yeah, all right, there's some tools to not do that. It can get real dicey.
Well, and I think that you mentioned Walgreens was wanting to tear down the firehouse on Franklin Street on St. Joseph Avenue there. And I live in that area in Franklin. And it's, you know, you mentioned earlier about sustainability. And I think it, you know, I think it goes beyond, you know, I don't know what that encompasses, but I think of like vibrancy. And like just that area, you know, they said it was kind of spurred by the residents. Amy Ward, the runs the Master Bar, she really, you know, she took on the whole Franklin Street Events Association and the bazaar, and they had a skating rink this winter. They had, you know, they got the Charles Dickens Christmas stuff, they got a Mardi Gras parade, and all that's just spurred up since these were there probably the last 5 years. Even. And you get a sense of just that growth, and you know, it, like I said, it's all congested there in a good way, you know, it's concentrated, so it's kind of nice to see that.
Well,
well,
it's interesting that you mentioned Washington District too, because while Evansville, we only have one district in that's preserved and with guidelines. Washington Riverside District's also the most preserved. Because Washington District, as you mentioned, makes actual loss 25% of the buildings now quarter century. And makes one wonder if there was a guidelines in that district, would they still belong to buildings at the rate which are damaged to or so demolition now, as we're talking right now. So and that applies to all the districts in that slide, I think. So while there's community pushback to preserve the buildings, should we do it for the historical architecture and for the city? Because Washington Avenue, most people, when you think Washington Avenue, you know it too, being a real good, and you've seen it too, I'm sure. It hurts the area, the community, the house prices are low. There's some magnificent, huge houses on Washington. So yeah, it's kind of like, how do we reach out to the leaders to.
And I've heard on some of those, just to get up to code is almost outweighs the cost of work. There was one on, I think on the corner of 8th Street in Washington, they, I think maybe 10 years, maybe 20 years ago, they sunk a bunch of city money to show what an exemplary remodel would look like. And I heard they just sunk way too much money into it and it floundered. And then they had the one maybe 3 or 4 years ago that was a little farther out that was successful, but I don't know how good the neighborhood that is.
You know, you mentioned it around the numbers though, the one, it's still there. It's kind of a gray blue brick painted. And, but they pulled it off and it's there, contributing to the tax base, you know, contributing to Vectren, not to the USR, Vectren to need money, but you know, that's a big deal. You know, Vectren employs people and that kind of thing. And it would be interesting to run the numbers because homeowners think of so many things as a term of a mortgage, 30 years, someday when you buy a house. Well, there's always. But you think of like a 30-year mortgage, some of these community-wide investments of saving or building over the life of a mortgage. It's really substantial.
Would you just want to
tell us
more about your project? Yeah, okay. So, I guess about 10 years ago,
I was actually in North Carolina. The time I grew up here was went to Rice High School on the west side. And, you know, I think I was looking back at older photos, and Willard Library had quite an extensive amount of photos on their website. And I was just running across all these old pictures of things I didn't know or wondered if it was in Evansville. And there was a lot of times even be identified. Like, where was that? You know, what is this? And, you know, my background is a math and science guy. So to me, it was like one big puzzle piece of trying to figure out things and find history. And I think probably the best I can do with preservation is, I guess, impart information. So, you know, I know when they were looking at Owen Block, I had a few people ask me about the history of it. You know, some people can find more than I can, but I generally had a lot of photos to find old maps, a lot of history in that regard. And there's been a lot more things on online now, but I think you get old newspapers. But one thing that got me thinking when I was walking in here, Claymire Hall that we're in, obviously probably a really wealthy family that donated to USI, but does anybody know where Claymire Park is? The dog park on the other side. But does anybody know why it's called Claymire Park? It was the First Avenue Brick and Tile Company. Right. So yeah, it was the old city dump. Well, it was an old brickyard. And I found another story about it, probably back in the day. Here's a good, not a great picture. But sorry, a little bit more about the site. What I've done is I've taken a lot of these photos and cross-linked them and identified different buildings, so it's hopefully easy to navigate and find things. Closed down, they consolidated with a couple other ones. There's one on T-Couple that's still there. But this one was kind of abandoned, and they basically made it a city dump. When then, as you guys can see here, there's Diamond Avenue in the background. Here's First Avenue, so right around here's your dump thing. And the city dump kept catching fire, I guess. So, you know, it's just these interesting things, and again, that's all, you know, you hear the word Claymire, you don't think twice about it sometimes, and it's kind of neat to think that there was an old brickyard Philip mentioned the Owen Block. So if you guys have anything you're looking for, you can type it in the historicevansville.com, you can type it in the bar, and stuff will generally come up. I will say fairly quickly, I guess I need to put something about Philip.
I was raised on Cumberland Presbyterian, though. I was geeked out when I went to his website and learned that before the Owen Block was there, it was the First Cumberland Presbyterian Church.
So here's an old 1888 map. I'll show that in a second. But there's the building. There was actually one. This one was probably the coolest one. It's not the best picture. The Owen Flats. It was from 1898. There's a photo of it right soon after the building. But you can see the brick road there. And then there's another one up here with a good shot up the road. You can see the towers on it. And that's actually, anybody know what Scottish Rite is? I don't know, is anybody from Evansville? I know a lot of college students are coming in now. Okay, well, Scottish Rite is across the street from it. It's got a horribly, it's got an ugly, ugly front. There's the church. And then I try and put a little quick timeline on here. It was bought by the Scottish Rite in 1909, and then they remodeled it. And probably most of you will recognize it as this beautiful building here. But what's interesting is you start looking, you're like, oh, hey, these clues are adding up. In the background, there's another old church. You know, you can kind of view it from the back, and you can kind of see where they cut the dormer off.
And the only defense there, there was a steeple fire, I think in the 50s. Have you seen photos of that, John?
I have not.
So they at least didn't tear down the steeple. It was already
right. And that's what I found sometimes. I get these points, segments, and again, the whole point of the site is to kind of archive and give timelines to things. But, you know, I found that as I go through things, I can get a pretty good pinpoint. You know, you think about, heck, on the west side here where we had a restaurant, I think the AT&T store used to be a Taco Bell. Before that, But then sometimes it kind of leads into, well, they didn't just tear it down. There was a fire and they had to rebuild it. So there's always a, I guess I am a little quick to point the finger at times, but, you know, when you have something like this and it changes, you kind of got to, it begs the question of what happened, why? And I think now, one of the quotes I always heard, Philip Simon, one of his, that he like, you know, when things get old, you know, they tend to remodel. If you can just make it past that 50-year window, it gets old and people want to redo it. But as soon as it gets beyond that point, it's super cool because, you know, you think about a lot of those Victorians that got torn down, and now they were really cool, I think, in the early 90s, and they, you know, wallpaper and the frilly stuff. And then probably the last 10 years of Craftsman's has gotten real popular. And if you go to Lowe's, all the styles of Craftsman's style, it just kind of, I guess, you know, kind of cycles. And now the mid-century modern's getting cool again. And I'm sure one day maybe whatever those things they built in the 70s will be cool again. I don't know, Hollywood. So, but I won't blame this too much.
I have a question for you about Scotty Drive.
Sure.
Have you been in there recently?
Yeah, apparently.
Is anybody making any efforts to save any of those materials?
Yeah, there was a huge Curran Miller auction. A lot of the stuff has been salvaged. Doors, that kind of things. And there's an auction for a lot of the personal property as well. The architectural salvage is kind of handled on a case-by-case basis. Salvage committees kind of in there. The architectural renovators, I think, have given that the eagle off the side of the building. So they did a good faith effort. They really did not. Rocky, at the Scott Trail was super approachable and helpful. He did not want to see that stuff go. There was something with the attic that would have got crunched if he hadn't told people that the original window that survived the steeple fire was in the attic. And that's now for sale at $1,200. It's beautiful, but it's huge. Like, look at the 6-foot round window in their party basement. That's a pretty big party basement. You got a 6-foot round window, but it's for sale at $1,200 at the G Salvage.
And
they've done a good job.
You bring up a good point. You know, when we first started looking, we had the house sitting on Wabash, and it's a Craftsman. And for us to find old doors, we were going to Indianapolis. We went to Springfield, Illinois, Nashville. We almost got some doing. In the past 3-4 years, we've gotten two in town that are pretty stocked. The FHG got kind of a collaborated with the city, so now that they can demo and they'll scrap out old doors, old trim, doorknobs, a lot of the staples that you can use in, if you're refurbishing an old house. And really, you could probably accent a new house if that was your style too. So. Again, real quick, districts, I've got different districts that you can kind of look at. These are kind of one of my first attempts at kind of getting neighborhoods around town. I'll just click on Independence. And here you can pick on almost any buildings, different schools, different things.
So each one of those points is a photo, correct?
The link to the actual building. So here you go. That's your
series of buildings. Yeah.
And then when you go to it, then it's got a little history about it. And if you click here, you can see all the images of Mesker. Some of them are kind of in the background, some are overhead. But again, and then I love these old aerial shots. You cannot beat these because you pick one of these. This is a good example of a downtown renewal here. See it on here, but a lot of these will have mouse overs where you can see the box of what the building is and click on that. And these specific ones don't have that. But there's categories. I don't think I maintain this so much. I kind of grouped them into different parts, so that was one way to look at it quickly. Photo gallery. This is a neat thing I did. Basically, all these photos. I think we have over about 6,000 photos now, and I haven't kept up with as much as I'd like to the last couple. About a year and a half, but you know, the buildings are all there, and then one thing, you hit refresh, new windows. You mentioned about the Scottish Rite. This is another example of the Owl's Home. This is a building on First Street, mm-hmm. First Avenue,
yeah.
And it used to be a gorgeous house, Historic Evansville has got a Facebook page you can sign up. I'll usually post if we do a walking tour there. And I think that's a great way to get people involved. When I would walk around the neighborhood, you know, you can walk almost a mile in any direction and just come across tons of old buildings. Sometimes you'll run across old train tracks that used to be there. You'll find, like Philip said, with the 1808 and the retaining wall, you just find different emblems signed on things. You can see an old building. You can see maybe old footsteps, like old stairs that went up to a building that's now gone. Just a lot of different things. But I've got a lot of these presentations online, so you can feel free to look at those. One of the things in the map section, here's a list of neighborhoods. There's a lot of things there, a little bit of history about each of them. These bird's eye views are amazing references. That's not a great picture. But in the 1880s, they did this really cool map of Evansville with just tremendous detail. And then actually, they did an even more thorough one in 1888 here. Again, just, you know, almost like a cartoon sketch like you'd see in an old social studies book. But that helped me then go back in, and now with these old pictures, I can zoom in, and then you can see that that's the courthouse in that picture, the way I've got the site programmed. So again, you could probably just find any building and hopefully find out enough that you need about it. One last thing that I'll just kind of, as a side note, is kind of fun, is I'll get a lot of people will email me, and they'll say, you know, can you tell me about the history of my house? And, you know, sometimes I can pinpoint a range of when it was built. I do get some people asking if they have blueprints of their house, and I'm like, I don't. I've actually found a few on the newspapers, but I'll get a lot of people too. They'll, you know, if you look at Walk and Plow, mine's probably one of the few. Walk is an old company in Evansville. Mine's one of the few websites with Walk and Plow, so they'll ask me what an old, you know, farming plow is worth, and I don't have any answer for that. But again, it's kind of a nice resource, and from what I've heard, you guys use it a lot. I've heard a lot of good things about it, and I will do it as a hobby site. But you know, at some point, I'm going to handle the reins. So if anybody's interested, it's kind of a fun thing to do. Is it right? I'm paying internship. But
so you're saying you get money to do this?
I get no money. You don't even do sidebar ads or anything?
No, I kind of didn't want to. A lot of these are Willard pictures. Willard would have, here's our picture, you know, here's his picture, and they wouldn't have any links. So it's like, when I have to look something up, like I do web design. So to me, it was like, if I have this building, I'd like to see all the pictures of that building. And it just kind of went hand in hand. And so I think it's neat when you see these old pictures, and especially like an old landscape, and you can see another old building in the background, and just maybe the puzzles fit together, I think.
Yes.
Well, actually, it's not a question, it's more of a comment. We've been talking about historic preservation here in terms of material structures, but I think that what your website is showing us is that images are extremely important for us mm-hmm. to remember what existed.
Right.
And I just have to say, a lot of people, when grandma dies or parents die, they go through their attics and all, and they'll find these things and they'll throw them out.
Yeah.
So if you come across letters, diaries, maps, blueprints, photographs, contact us here at USI, contact the Willard Library, find somebody who can tell you where these can be deposited, because that's an important part of our history.
Yeah, that's the other thing. You can't make these old photos. They're it's a finite set of pictures, and I get giddy when I see one that I haven't seen before. You know, it's like, wow, that's, you know, such a cool, you know, snapshot of this building in 1920 or something.
The downtown library, the central branch, also has a really robust archives and
Willard Library has quite a few, like maybe 5,000 or 6,000 square feet of conditioned space that they store things.
Right, and I'm not knocking them at all.
That's super helpful. You go down to the basement Willard and say, hey, I'm looking for this, they'll immediately start helping you. It's really cool.
Like I said, I've worked with them too, so I'm not saying mine's better than Willard's, but you know, they have all that stuff, and this is almost you said earlier, it's an extension of Willard Library at USI, you know, Jennifer Green, you know, we've talked with her, and they're generally okay with me using the photos as long as I put it
part of a grant funded by the Institute for Museum and Library Services, and it was nearly $100,000 that stretched over 2 years, 3 years, 2 years, seemed to go on forever. But what we did is we had students who were here at USI in an African American history class, and what they did was they did research on buildings, churches, services that were in the African American community in the 1930s through the 1950s, which was basically the time that that federal housing project, Lincoln Gardens, was at its peak. And ultimately, what happened was that all the data that the students gathered was put into an interactive map, which, as far as I know, is still available on the African American Museum's website. And you can do some of the things that we were seeing on your maps, is you can go and you can click on one of the little icons to see what that business was, when it existed, who was the operator of it, what we know about it. And it was a really good project for the students to really get an understanding of what the geography was, the historical geography was, of this community in this very specific time period. And we have an article that's coming out. Donovan Waite and I have an article coming out in the Journal of the History feature that describes this project.
Okay, so we've heard a little bit about the past, right? Evansville's past with historic preservation and about the present, what's going on right now. And I know one thing that Chris wanted to do is also talk about the future of historic preservation. So we brought in young folks. Lucas, can you tell us a little bit about what you said? What about yourself?
Well, of course, I'm a realtor also, just like Joel, mainly interested in historic homes and historic preservation, though. Basically, I've loved historic homes and working in them since I first stepped in them, and I've always had an eye for historical buildings and saving them, because I've been to a lot of cities where historic preservation is something that they championed, and it's been actually quite a tourism item for them. Think of Savannah, Georgia, for example, or mentioned Georgia. Go down to Florida, the area down there, you go through the Northeast, they have a bunch of historic buildings here. And I've always seen Evansville as a place that could also have the same type of aura of sort of preservation to it. We certainly have the structures here, but we don't have the leadership and guidance and organization of these structures to lead some kind of helpful city preservation-wide effort. Like I mentioned, and Phil mentioned too, that at first our preservation district has been quite successful. We have the Wright's Home, which is around 10,000 visitors a year, and is successful on its own right, but I think we need to expand beyond the Wright's Home. Something I've been working on lately is trying to say the Cook Mansion, who everyone has seen. It's an eyesore, as the public has said. I've talked to a wide array of people about the Cook Mansion. It's actually on 16 North Fulton, for anyone that kind of knows where Fulton Avenue is. It's the only mansion left on Fulton, and you can pull it up, actually, if you want. Yeah, you can actually, it's on his website, too, yeah.
Oh, okay, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
No,
it's good. No.
Oh, come on.
But, that's the Charles or Henry Cook Mansion. Third,
nope. Nope, nope.
The
there was three right in a row.
Yeah.
No, not that's that one.
But, Phil, I know that you have worked extensively on this as well, so you might be able to just comment on this.
Well, this photo actually makes it look pretty good. This is a few years ago.
Yeah.
It's significantly worse today.
Yeah. I mean, I'll just give you the full disclosure. So when I was in the city, you know, part of the Department of Metropolitan Development's mission is historic preservation. It's a third of the way the public may understand the role of that city department, but it's a fraction of the staff and the budget. The priorities at the time were Owen Block and Peters-Margedant House and Cook House. You know, it's sort of like a terrible game in your head. Sometimes you think of like, well, what is the highest priority? You know, when you prioritize something, you know, again, you're telling somebody no, you know. And I often said, and this is just me, you can disagree, but I remember saying that I would drive a bulldozer through the Greyhound building if that was the only way we could save the Owen Block. But now, again, we say both. So you have to do the priorities. And Cook Mansion, based on its location,
location was certainly the bottom of the priorities. And I didn't want to do nothing. I didn't like the thought of the convention falling down someday and somebody saying, well, what did you try to do? We didn't have much money. I was at the time still trying to squirrel away, which I had, but the department had, and just didn't have the executive decision to spend it, but you know, about $300,000 spent to save the home book. That's in a great location. The end use is right there, the apartment, the easy cook mansion is next to a welding gas place, and a corridor that used to be a corridor of mansions, and now it's very industrialized. It's a good thing when you can smell the bread being baked, the bunny bread factory, but it's a very factory-driven corridor now. And so I got together with you in 2012, in December, I wanted every organization on the west side that might give a crap about that building, who might drive by it someday when it's gone and pick up the phone and say, we could have done something, we didn't know that it was about to come down. So it's sort of like a last call. And I had Dan Fulton at the time was the head of the West Side Met Club. I had the Germanium Corps there. I had Rotaract. I had the Junior League. I had the Junior Leagues who started the Wrightson Museum. The mayor himself was there. Indiana Landmarks was there. And the museum was there. The Arts Council was there to help take photos. I wanted the museum there because if we can't save the Cook Mansion, my hope, and I've sort of thrown in the towel on this, I'm less involved. The convention now, but I would still hope, but I say it like this, I don't know if the murals are in good shape, but at the time, 4 years ago, the murals on the inside were totally salvageable. And so if it was going to come down, could we at least save the murals of the Cook family's home in Germany? They're all over the house, and put those in the museum. So at that time, I proposed the city could spend $50,000. I would rationalize that in my department. $50,000 to help the gutters and make it watertight, at least from the top. It may not be roof and siding, but it can get pretty close to make it watertight. And if these other organizations can, and it just, at the time, there weren't, who's going to sign up for a $500,000 to $1 million project? You know, we had USI, also engaged through Mark Bernhardt. Would USI want to receive it, put it on campus, in a juxtaposed location of Rolling Hills, a place where you can stay when you're not having to go from Bloomington to USI? And we had a house mover there as well to get the cost of, it would be $120,000 to move the cookhouse somewhere. And it just, at the time, didn't pan out. At the time, it was remarkably impressive. I toyed with putting pictures of the 2012 tour in my presentation. I didn't because I have no idea if it's still in good shape, and I don't want to go to false hopes. Because it might be a lot worse.
I don't know.
In 2012, it impressed a lot of people. They thought it'd be worse based on the outside. But once water starts getting in, and siding has come off the front of the house, water's hitting that plaster, and plaster is much stronger than drywall. Plaster can get 70% wet before it loses structural stability. Drywall can get like 5% wet and then done. But so it eventually is going to fall down. If the owner, and unfortunately, the owner turned down an offer, a very good offer in 2000, of someone who's going to make a bed and and they just wanted to live in money. So it's stuck in a sea of indecision.
Well, I've talked to the homeowner, and I've also spoken with the caretakers who used to live in the carriage house, so I know quite a bit about the house at this moment. Basically, the caretakers moved out in 2015 because the carriage house has failed wiring in it now. But it was a big legal conflict because there was a divorce in the family who owned it. And I know the male owner named Milan DeLong. And he spoke with me. I spoke with him just a couple weeks ago. And he said he has no business interest in it, but he would also like to see the house restored. And his wife is one that currently owns it. And she's, well, we don't know where she is. And that's kind of where I play a role. Because I've had Stuart Seavey from Indiana Landmarks actually contacting me, asking me if I can contact the owner so we can try to get Indiana Landmarks involved to save the house. Because I would be happy to try to spearhead a campaign, which may or may not succeed, but I'd rather try than have it fail. And we kind of hit that end. But I did get an outside tour of it from a neighbor, and not as bad as you can imagine. There's four broken out windows on the second floor. So that's with the rain in December, I kind of got concerned as to what is actually accruing inside the residence. So it's kind of a battle of finding and acquiring.
One thing I'll say too, that kind of going, you said, you know, it's got to go. And that's the case sometimes. But I think, you know, if you're younger and motivated and you can get into these houses, sometimes you do know what you're doing, sometimes you don't know what you're doing. You know, and I say this as someone who just bought a dilapidated farmhouse kind of historian. You know, it's not that you can't do, a lot of times it's not that you can't do it either money or at least some sweat equity. You know, and there's obviously worse case, you know, worse off buildings than not. But, you know, you'd be surprised. I see a lot of these home shows, and I'm like, oh my gosh, the paint's ugly or something. You're like, just paint it, you know? It's like, it's not the end of the world. Or like, they see like a wallpaper, and they're like, I don't like wallpaper. Like, we'll take off the wallpaper, you know? You know, you see, basically, I look a lot of times at these old houses. You're undoing all the damage that was done since it was built a lot of times. But, you know, a terrible renovation in the 50s when they did an ugly kitchen or something. And, you know, I guess it's up to how much you want to, you know, put into it. And I guess something like that, but you said it's in a bad location, and that would be an investment. But some of these downtown ones, that, you know, the prices are low, and, you know, if you feel like putting in time into it, and, you know, you can single-handedly preserve it. And I think, you know, I've been posting a lot of pictures of this farmhouse that we've been working on, and people get excited about that stuff. It's spreads the word, not just about your place, but just that, oh, hey, this guy can redo a house, and you know, look how cool it looks now, look how bad it used to look.
I want to be clear, I don't think the Cook Mansion is structurally done, but it will eventually come down. This kind of gets back to one of your questions about the enemies of what are the enemies of historic preservation. I mean, not exactly what you asked, but and sort of a unintended negative consequence of our low crime rate that we talked about earlier. Evansville has a really low tolerance for blight. And a lot of communities, there are so many abandoned houses that they don't care. They maybe have an ability to see the beauty in something like the cookhouse. Whereas in the cookhouse in 2012, you know, you get a text message from your boss. I was on a litter pickup. This is blighted. We need to tear it down. And I said, no. But when the community is concerned about crime and blight, that can be a sticking point as well. It certainly is on Washington Avenue. There have been homes torn down on Washington Avenue that had a leaking valve in the roof, and that was it. And the salvage company taking the salvage girls out last summer were literally apologetic and saying, why are we doing this? This home doesn't need to be torn down. And so, long story short, if preservation matters to you, make sure your elected officials know. Like, just speak up and make sure. Because right now, it's almost like a germaphobe. You know, it's like clean is better than dirty, and a vacant lot is better than a blighted house, and not necessarily. Vacant lots are blight as well. It's blight on the tax roll. It's a blight. It looks dumb. It's a missing tooth from a smile. You know, a vacant lot is still blight. So, am I saying we need to increase our tolerance of blight in our community? Not necessarily. But that's kind of at play, though. I mean, if you see the abandoned structures in Detroit, my God, it looks like a war zone. They don't give a crap about it. People are in there snowboarding and building ramps with snow and doing skate parks in there, and stuff's falling into the street. And thankfully, we don't have those conditions, but for the sake of historic preservation, it sometimes affects our understanding of, oh my gosh, the cookhouse needs to be torn down. And structurally, I don't think it does that.
What would it be to sell it as it is right now in condition?
Right now, I would say it would be hard bargain to find someone to take them down. Yeah,
I think. Unfortunately, when Milan Gerlach was on the tour with us, I got this awesome picture of one of the people reacting to what he said. And no offense to Milan, but he thought he could strip it of all of his architectural salvage and gut it. And so he gutted Cookhouse for $120,000, and you're so far out of the realm of possibility. You know, the demolition of the house alone is probably $10,000 to $12,000. A vacant lot of that condition is probably only $6,000. So it may have literally zero value. It may have negative value. I mean, it's just.
Yeah.
not a walkable neighborhood. It's not something that that tourists would be necessarily interested in. So what would be the purpose of restoring this house for the west side at a place like USI? Not saying USI would take it, obviously I don't have any power, but you know, considering those sorts of venues, what would be the benefit to the community of moving this house?
We talked about the house museum with the tour in 2012, and when we talk about any new nonprofit group and community of existing nonprofit groups with finite resources to support those nonprofit groups, all the existing nonprofit groups tend to roll their eyes and start stabbing things in their ear, because you know, what's the sustainable mission for that organization to continue to pay the bills and buy your exit? I got really close to my mind. Of course, everything is good in your mind. You know, it is part of Evansville's brewery history, to answer your question. So, I mean, this guy was the Mad Daddy Brewer, which I think he shut down the plant over a union dispute, and that's a problem. Maybe screw the union, we're not unionizing, and so Cook Brewery did that. But that could be wrong. But I think there was a big union dispute related to it. And then the city was starting to decline in that area anyway, so a couple decades later, and that's where the Civic Center. So the Civic Center is partially, you know, where the federal building is partially where the brewery was. But it's what's breweries. So we talked about a brewery museum, and we talked about a German American Heritage Museum. But house museums across the country are in decline. And thankfully, the Wrights Home, with a great management and good board, is still increasing its sort of solvency and role in the community. But so it certainly was a understandable why the group of community folks in 2012 didn't jump at a new house museum.
So, first of all, were you saying that the owner of the Cook residence was part of Evansville's Brewing history?
The building, yeah.
Right.
And his I think his two sons lived next door. His brewmaster. The Cook brewmaster, think of like the Taroni brewmaster or the Ten Man brewmaster. The Cook brewmaster was so wealthy, his house was insane. He was in Washington Avenue, just come down in 2006. So yeah, it was a big deal. I mean, it was huge.
Okay, so I guess my question, kind of comment, is that you were just mentioning how house museums all over the country are kind of declining in the amount of attendance they're seeing. And for me, this is not based on any evidence other than just observation, is that people are transitioning from kind of a, in terms of preservation, from kind of a save it because it's beautiful, because it has value in the community, to now people want to also understand the bigger context. They want everything in its place in history. How can you get the community, who is your biggest potential funding source, how can you get the community interested in something like the Cook Mansion by putting it into its historical context? You say it has this relation to Evansville's really long and really rich brewing history, which is something that a ton of people here are very interested in. How can we, with this project and similar projects at the city, how can we put everything in its historical context and really bring that information to the community
And that property owner was thrown under the bus, the local media, and the council started throwing them away. Yes, they didn't make good on their development plans for 2011, blah, blah, blah. But thank goodness they were willing to work with the team, you know. And if they were willing to work with the initiative, then the owner, you know, called you, that'd be a great thing. So that's one missing link, but that's not the answer of how. And so the how for Owen Block was social media combined with Indiana Landmarks. I am a firm believer that Facebook could not have saved the Owen Block that were built on the plan, and that Indiana Landmarks could have not saved the Owen Block with their typical model. It was a crisis, it was a unique thing, but the two together told the story, it told the connection. We originally set out, on Owen Block to plan a funeral. We did not think we were going to succeed, and we literally were having conversations about how do you eulogize the building on the site, have a block party, have 10 men, have a huge drunken funeral for the building. And then learn, okay, how do we grip that? Well, within a couple of weeks, it was really obvious we were going to be successful. So we had planned out to not even talk about fundraising for maybe 6 to 8 weeks to tell that story. So some of it was just maybe how you structure your campaign. Another reason why I would say go to the National Trust, because there's so many cool little campaigns to inspire you all over the country. A courthouse initiative in Texas where they had a little $5,000 budget. They danced up and made costumes and made like a write love letters to the courthouse campaign around Valentine's Day. There's a number of ways you can do that, but in this day and age, the future is certainly going to involve social media on some level. The nice thing about Indiana Landmarks is it's the largest statewide preservation organization in the United States of America, and that's not a per capita comparison. It's literally, they're bigger than New York or California on the statewide. So they have some serious skills and knowledge and resources, but they still don't have, you know, they're not Bill Cook. They can just write a $20 million check, you know. So, but social media combined with Landmarks, I think, is how we could be successful, how Lucas could be successful, how we could be successful with Cook Mansion Crafts, but we got to have a willing owner as well.
Involved
part of this, and in telling the story was, it has been, it continues to be a huge part of the Peters-Margedant House. It's a tiny little house. It looks like a park shelter that you can pull up to it, like a state park, and give them your money through the car. It's tiny. It changes the history books of architectural history in America, but a lot of people don't think it's pretty. And so that's another reason why the Owen Block worked, is everyone thought it was pretty. One big rub with preservation-minded folks, and it gets into the beauty across countries. We've had this conversation here. There's not really any buildings threatened by it, but it's brutalism. The Civic Center is a perfect, beautiful example of brutalist architecture. Tons of concrete, little convertible windows. It doesn't play well with the urban street grid. Large campuses when cities are bad and dirty, and we got to build these big things. But there, is it beauty, or it's also preserving just a part of the record? And there was the Barton Towers in Indianapolis was a great brutalist piece of architecture. The Housing Authority built this amazing development around, a development that our Housing Authority built. We'd all be excited, super cool, mixed use, mixed income, and brought two corridors back, like Mass Ave and Side Street, where there was just grass in front of Barton Towers. Imagine like the Kennedy Towers near the hotel site in Evansville, just kind of a ho-hum apartment tower with some subsidized units for folks that, you know, need some affordable housing. Well, this was this really concrete, imagine like the Civic Center version. But they obscured it, and some architectural fans in Indy were like, no, you ruined the Barton Tower, brutalist piece of history. And then other people were like, dude, but you got so many more affordable housing units, and we connected two corridors, so again, there's always rubs. But brutalism is a fun one because a lot of people think it's ugly. And if everyone thinks it's ugly, are we gonna lose all the brutalist architecture? Because no offense, a lot of people thought it was ugly. So that, yeah, beauty is certainly a part of this, and it's not always about what's beautiful.
Do any of you know anything about the little red house or barn or whatever it is in Newburgh that they just got money to save and move? Because I have seen that ever since we moved to the Evansville area. And I'm really glad it's being saved, but what was it?
I think it was a tiny little something to do with the school, but the people in Newburgh don't agree on it. Some people think it's actually not at all. There's some, I don't know who's going to solve the answer, it maybe it's already been solved. But I know last summer there were some pretty prominent folks in Newburgh on historic preservation or town council or both or something who weren't quite sure it was as old as they said it was. They thought maybe somebody had rebuilt it in the 1950s to look that way. So I'm not quite sure that that is answerable with 100% certainty.
And Kristalyn, last question.
Yeah.
Do you have any thoughts on I want to thank you all for being here today, and I guess I just want to leave us with a sign of hope. So I think that, you know, Phil said, if you're interested in historic preservation, do something about it, right? So this historic preservation of built environments and this historic story, these things wouldn't happen without local activists and the community involved. So if you're interested, come up and talk to us afterward or shoot us an email.